Friends, yesterday we touched upon the background to where we are today, and I congratulated the IIT Bombay for having taken up this initiative, which may, if it is properly guided and people take deep interest in what we are trying to do or provoke you to think about, it can become a paradigm shift in understanding India and unearthing its potentialities in a manner it has not happened in the last 50-60 years of our independence. Now, before I get into the core of the subject, which I will do from next sessions, I want to deal with why it is important for us to understand India and how branding of India is important. You know, from about 2004-05, branding a nation has become a very important function in geopolitics, economics, trade relations, tourism, and generally the reputation of a country depends on its image and its acceptability. You know, the world was moved by raw power for the last 2000 years. In fact, there is so much of evidence available as to how the world was, say, before the 20th century. And before the 20th century, the number of people who were exterminated is 276 million. In 20th century, which is supposed to be the modern world, the number of people eliminated, 203 million. It is important to know where these massacres and manslaughters took place. You know, in this period, India's tally from 13th century to 19th century was 4.5 million. This is the Islamic conquest of India. Before that, there were Ashokan War, Kalinga, in which the death was estimated at 100,000 plus. And in Sati, the estimates, I will give you the sites which show, the estimates are in thousands rather than in millions. And in Thagis, the death is again thousands. Why I am mentioning this is, when the whole world was barbaric, there was no barbarism in India. It's a proven record today. Despite that, Winston Churchill called us a barbaric society. Karl Marx called us a semi-barbaric race. It's absolutely disproved in the last 20 years. It is important for us to understand that if 1/6 of humanity, at one time even we were in more than 1/6 of humanity, if they had maintained relative peace, not indulged in this kind of manslaughter, killing people for no reason other than the fact I don't like you, there is something to look into this civilization. So the important point when we are trying to brand India is to know that from 1983, the grammar of geopolitics began to change. Joseph Nye, a Harvard professor, wrote a book on soft power. He advised America, which was the hardest power the civilizations of the world have known. He said, hereafter this hard power concept is not going to sell. You should now move on to projecting America as a soft power, as an acceptable power, as a comfortable power, as something which will promote peace and harmony, promote friendly relationships, and so don't project your atom bombs, your missiles, your warfare technology. Of course, in their terms he said, you project Harvard, Stanford, Mickey Mouse, Coca-Cola. See, they have only these soft powers. So project these things. You can conquer the world by Coca-Cola. You can conquer the world by your educational institutions. Why are you projecting this hard power? See, this began to shift the global opinion. Hard power is necessary. Without hard power, you can't defend soft power. And that is what a country like Japan lost out. In a way, Germany also lost out because of their historical blunder in the Second World War. But whatever remains, if today America is projecting itself as soft power, it is because it has a very hard power backing to defend, advance, promote, advertise, and convince the people about its soft power. Apart from its economic power, apart from its military power, it is now trying to project itself as a soft power. This change has been recognized in global geopolitical, economic, cultural, and even military discourse, that we are there to restore peace. We are not there to promote war. Even in warfare, the concept of soft power has been introduced. You know, this is now recognized as branding nations. It is important to brand a nation, for which there has to be national effort, in which the media has to be involved, in which educational institutions have to be involved, governments have to be involved, NGOs have to be involved. And you can never brand a nation except on the basis of truth. Why it is important is, are we branding India in the proper sense of the term? I am going to give you some examples as to how we are de-branding, demonizing India, for which we have absolute proof. Take for instance, rapes, the Delhi rape. You know, the Delhi rape woke up the world to the issue of ill-treatment of women. It arrested the whole country for 1 year, or 1 month. Rupee value was collapsing, nobody was bothered about it. Economy wasn't going to dogs, nobody was bothered about it. That one incident shook India, shook the world. The entire country came on the street. What does that mean? I am going to read out to you an article which was written in the Guardian magazine by one Emmer O'Toole, which is very important for us to know, because we were projected as a country of rapists and killers. This Delhi rape took place in the last week of December. This article appeared on the 1st of January. This article was written by one Emmer O'Toole, a lady journalist. Delhi gang rape, look westward in disgust. Coverage of Damini's death strikes a particularly ironic note following the recent media controversy over a rape in Ohio. There is something uncomfortably neo-colonial about the way Delhi gang rape and the subsequent death of the woman, now known as Damini, is being handled in UK and US media. While India's civil and political spheres are alight with protests and demands for changes to the country's culture of sexual violence, commentators here are using the event to simultaneously demonize the Indian society, lionize our own, and minimize the enormity of the Western rape culture. Particularly blatant example of this is Libby Purvis's piece for the Times. She says, "The Delhi bus rape should shatter our Bollywood fantasies." For Purvis, Westerners enjoy a romanticized view of India, all heady spirituality and marigold hotels, and especially romantic in their views for reasons Purvis neglects to address are the British. The upright Europeans have sentimentally ignored the murderous and hyena-like male contempt that Purvis says is the Indian cultural norm. Neatly excised from her account is, however, the relationship between poverty, lack of education, repressive attitude towards women, by extension, the role of Europe in creating sustained poverty in former colonies. This is her way of saying, in India, if some wrong things happen, you must understand it. But what she says about the Western societies is shocking. Attitudes towards women in the East were once used by the colonialists, etc. When it finishes calling Indian men hyenas, Purvis's article said that the Westerners have the luxury of fretting out thriller feminist issues such as magazine images, rude remarks, and men not doing housework. Does anyone else see an unattractive historical pattern here? Her article is not by any means the only one to report on this issue, as if rape is something that only happens over there, something we civilized folk in the West have somehow put behind us. Elsewhere, the message is subtler, but a misplaced sense of cultural superiority shines though. For example, this BBC article states, as if shocking, the statistics that a woman is raped in Delhi every 14 hours, that equates to 625 a year. Yet in England and Wales, which has a population of 3.5 times that of Delhi, we find the figure of recorded rapes of women that is proportionately 4 times larger, 9,509. Similarly, the Wall Street Journal decries the fact that in India, just over a quarter of the alleged rapists are convicted. In US, only 24% of the alleged rapes even result in an arrest, much less, never mind a conviction. The most important thing, the coverage of Damini's death strikes a particularly ironic note following the recent media discovery of a rape in Steubenville, Ohio, of a 16-year-old girl, allegedly by members of the high school football team. The case is that the young woman was dragged, drunk, unresponsive from party to party, where she was sexually abused. The brutal death of Damini has spurred the Indian society, civil society, to its feet, causing protest and unrest, bringing women and men into the streets, vocal in their demands for change. Sonia Gandhi met with the women's parents. The Amri and the states of Punjab and Haryana cancelled the New Year celebrations. What happened in US? In Steubenville, football crazy town folk blamed the victim, and it took a blogger, Alexandria Goddard, who is now being sued, for a follow-up article in New York Times 4 months after the incident to get a nationwide attention of the story. You know, the first arrest in Steubenville rape was made after the Delhi rape made the issue a global issue. Now, the American government has constituted a study to study the harm that is being caused to women because they are women, and it has come out that 1/5 of the American women were raped at one point or the other. And the Lancet magazine, which is one of the most prestigious medical magazines, has come out with the report that the rapes in India and Bangladesh are the lowest in the world. And I must now read out what the Nation Mastercom says about nearly 1 in 5 women in US survey say they have been sexually assaulted. This is the American government survey, an exhaustive government survey of rape and domestic violence released on Wednesday, that is 14th December 2011, affirmed that sexual violence against women remains endemic. And it goes to say that there is no way this can be stopped by education or other thing. It requires large scale effort by the people. You know why in India this became an issue? It is because women are really respected in India. That is why people came on the road and protested. And that turned against India. And one blogger by name Maria Wirth, she wrote, judging from media reports, she wrote on 27th January 2014, she is a German. Judging from media reports, India has a big problem with the rape. No other country seems to come even close. All over the globe, another rape in India is reported ever so often. On my last visit to Germany, I jolted when on 27th December 2013, the most popular TV news ended with another gang rape in India. It was only one of the 5 topics of the 15 minutes telecast. I want you to know how a news item can be repeated, replicated, retelecast to brand India, when the fact is something very, very different. The deluge of rape reports in India started with the shameful gang rape of a young woman in a bus in Delhi on December 16th. Jyoti died, 6 culprits were convicted, etc. The gang rape received unprecedented publicity. It reached national and local news all over the globe. It reached even a friend in Slovenia who is usually oblivious of what is happening in the world. Why was it broadcast all over the world with such intensity? Was it because Indians protested in such a big way and demanded harsh punishment? And it didn't happen in Steubenville, and it won't happen. I am going to show you the figures of which are the countries which have the highest rape rates in the world. 10,277 out of 100,000 raped every year in France. 7,292, it is a nationmaster.com which quotes the UN statistics. And Germany 7,292, Russia 6,208, Sweden, a country which is number 8 in Human Development Index, where gender equality is almost complete, 4,901, Argentina, etc. You know where India is? India comes as 102 in the descending order. 1.7 per 100,000 is the rape rate in India. But how the country was debranded? And do we care to know the facts? And we don't look at the facts at all. And when I wrote that the rape to population ratio in England is 120 times India's, it is 30 times India's in US. When I wrote the article, nobody challenged it in the media, but nobody said, yes, we are wrong in branding India as a nation of rapists and killers. Why it is important that such news, unless it is founded on facts, will cause travel advisories by countries. England issues travel advisory to people going to India, please be careful, you may get raped. It's very important that we brand the country properly. If you want FDI, if you want your products to be sold, if you want your tourists to come, you see, economics is no more related to market, just related to market. It is related to the larger idea of a society. Have you ever told the world that we were never a slaughtering race? And one king who happened to kill 100,000 people wrongly declared war is wrong and never fought a war afterwards and made the country that fight to feel that fighting war was a sin. We never branded. And that in India, killing has been so low in that period when the whole world's business was to kill each other. Rape. Now you take poor status of women. You know, there is a broad difference. This is something which the feminists in India must understand, women leaders in India must understand more than others. You know, in there has been a discourse in the world about women's rights, because Indian women may have to tell the world as to how there has to be gender harmony more than gender conflict. This is a subject which I have been studying for the last 20 years. In 1993, when I was in America, an incident triggered me into studying this subject. A very good friend of mine by name Stacy Goff, he was a lawyer and he was a very good looking man. That is why his parents named him Stacy, a woman's name. And he was writing and I was looking at his pen. He said, Guru, you like this pen, I'll give it to you. I said, no, I'm looking at your handwriting, it is like a girl's handwriting. He took offense to it. He said, how could you say my handwriting is like a girl's handwriting? I said, Stacy, in our place it's a compliment. He said, Guru, please be careful, we don't take it as a compliment. I was surprised. That's the conflict. This conflict has a source in tradition. You know, in the Western religious belief, a man was made in the image of God. A woman came out of the rib bone of man. And so till the 7th century, there was a dispute whether a woman was a human being or not. In the 7th century, by 41 to 40 votes, they admitted, yes, a woman is a human being, but not equal to man. You know, this you may dismiss as some traditional thinking, some religious people were imposing their views, but it transmuted into politics. You know, America has been having democracy for 150 years before it gave women the voting rights in 1924. Britain had democracy for 800 years. They gave voting right to women only in 1926. After women went into streets and there were lathi charge and police firing, women suffrage movement. And in France and Italy, 1945. Can you imagine when the Swiss women got voting rights? Any of you? They got voting rights in 1972. Sucheta Kriplani became the chief minister of Uttar Pradesh, the largest state of India, when the women literacy in Uttar Pradesh was less than 25%. Indira Gandhi became the prime minister of India in 1966, when the literacy rate of women all India was less than 30%. And no one even questioned whether there should be voting rights for women or not when India went into electoral mode. In fact, there are studies, eco-feminists have studied, that the entire Indian freedom movement was fought in the name of a woman, Bharat Mata, Vande Mataram. Feminist power transformed itself into a political phenomenon. He said this never happened in the West, because a woman was never associated with power. In fact, the power was symbolized in a woman here. So this made me study the Western society, and in 2001 I took 3 pictures of Durga Lakshmi Saraswati in a lecture tour, where I had a meeting in which many Western women participated, in which I showed this is our goddess of power, this is our goddess of knowledge, this is our goddess of wealth. Their eyes popped out. Goddess? God can be woman? You know, the idea that God can be woman is alien to the concept of women in the West. I said, yes, our God can be woman, our God can be man, our God can be man and woman, our God can be beyond both. Then I said, it is not only our God can be woman, there are traditions in which women are worshipped as God. Then I explained to them the concept of Kanya Pujan and Suhasini Pujan and all that. They were shocked. This is respect for women. Western women revolted to get their rights because they were not respected. You know, there are estimates which show, some show a very outlandish estimates of 9 million women being burnt at stakes. But the estimate is at least 100,000 women were burnt at stakes, physically burnt. So I am not going into whether, I don't want to debrand, demonize any nation. But why this brand that in India women are only subjected to this kind of treatment? Where is the research about the past in India? Where is the comparative study of what the Western world was doing to women and what we have been? Where is one scholastic paper, one educational institution taking up this work? Is so important to brand India. And branding India is so important for economic development of India, economic modeling of India. So what we have missed out in the entire discourse is that we have accepted an inferior mentality. We have accepted that we have never been a civilized race, because this is what Karl Marx said in 1853 when he wrote those couple of articles in New York Herald Tribune, about which I will explain in later. And later Winston Churchill said in 1931 that it is a barbaric nation, and we accepted it. We quote Winston Churchill even today. On what basis they said it? Who questioned it? Only a person like Mahatma Gandhi had the guts to answer when that lady by name, she wrote a book on Mother India, Catherine Mayo. And that book was so full of this muck on India, that these are barbaric people, uncivilized people, uncultured people, less than human beings. She didn't say that, but this what she meant. So people went to Mahatma Gandhi and asked him, sir, this is creating such a bad image about India, our people, our culture, our way of life, you have to do something. Then Mahatma Gandhi, you know, is a true person. He read the whole book. He said, I don't have the time, but still I have to read it, because so many people have put pressure on me that I should read this book. And after reading that book, he wrote one sentence and that destroyed that book. He said, it is a gutter inspector's report. One sentence, the entire book was demolished. We need such leaders to rebrand India. But we have leaders who will support Catherine Mayo today. We have writers, we have editors, we have leaders, we have feminists, we have academicians. Yes, yes, what she is saying is also true. There is no society without a gutter. There is no society without a negative. There is no society without inferior people. There is no society without inferior unbecoming conduct. But that does not make the society. Take America today. In America, 41% of the babies born are for unwed mothers. It is a civilizational chaos, cultural decline, social fall, collapse of the family system. But they are saying it is output of modernity and individualism and gender rights. The same thing which can cause the collapse of a nation, it has caused the collapse of our economy itself, American economy itself, which I will tell later. 51% of the American families are led by single parents, most of them women. 55% of the first marriages end in divorce. 67% of the second marriages end in divorce. 74% of the third marriages end in divorce. These are all considered to be celebrated output of modernity. This should go to the negatives of a nation. But they have said, you know, if you have high level of individualism, if you have gender rights, if you have this kind of, you know, competitive world, these are all something which you have to now take care of unwed mothers, you have got to take care of children born outside wedlock, and you have passed laws in Sweden nationalizing all children born because there is no parents to take care of. These are all indices of modernity. They have changed the definition of what is civilization, culture, social norms, because their brand is important for them. But here, on the contrary,
sir, I read an article in the Mint a few weeks back, which was in a US journal, which said that higher divorce rates are better for the economy.
Yeah.
Because they lead to more consumption.
Yeah, that I will come to later. Destruction of families is necessary for promoting economics.
You are supporting this view.
Violence and terror. India is a violent country. You know what is the crime rate per 100,000, crime rate per 1,000? It is 0.64 in India. In developed nations like America, many Western countries, it is between 76 and 81 per 1,000. In India, it is 0.64. Number of people jailed in prison, it is out of 150. 56 country, in the descending order, India is 153. The number of people jailed is 0.2. And rape 1.7 per 100,000 population. This is a UN documented statistics. But have we ever projected India as a country with the least amount of crime in the world, prison population in the world, least amount of rape in the world, despite the fact that we are not a fully policed country? You know, we have 6,68,000 towns and villages. Can anyone tell me how many police stations we have? 12,800 police stations. I come from a village. Till my 15th year, I never saw policemen in village except twice when there were elections. Otherwise, policemen never came to our village. There was no theft. We used to keep the doors open and go to temples. That's the case with thousands of villages. Have you ever projected this? That most of the crimes in India are urban crimes. The villages will clash once in 3 years because some caste, one lady has run away with another, there will be a clash. That is bound to be. And you will say, no, these are barbaric societies, see what they have done. But 3 years they remained peaceful, 1 year they lost their cool, and for which you are branding the whole nation as barbaric. So
So why I am saying this is, the brand of India is very important. Why is it important? You know, now I will take you back to 1897 when Swami Vivekananda was traveling, and he began traveling from 1897-98 across the country. You know, we just completed celebrating his 150th anniversary. It is a very, very important U-turn in the history of India, Swami Vivekananda. So when he went, he saw only hunger, poverty, deprivation, a defeated nation which has accepted defeat. In those 20 years from 1880 to 1900, India witnessed 23 largest famines in the world, and nearly in that period the death is estimated, apart from the Bengal famine in 1920s, it was estimated at least 20 million, because Indian food was exported by the colonies. India's distribution system was affected. The normal distribution system of India did not work. So when he came and saw all this, he was heartbroken, but he had the confidence that this nation will rise. And so he went and spoke in the Chicago conference that here is a country which has the cure for the ills of the world. You know what he mentioned? He mentioned two incidents. He said, we kept in our bosom the last remnants of the Jewish civilization, and we kept in our bosom and protected the only surviving Parsi culture. And he spoke only 471 words. He was given 5 minutes, 2.5 minutes he lost because people began clapping when he mentioned sisters and brothers of United States of America. He lost 2.5 minutes. He spoke 471 words. I have addressed 5 university meetings on Swami Vivekananda's 150th anniversary celebrations. I asked in each meeting, I asked the students, please, anyone who has read that speech, lift your hands. In 4 universities, nobody lifted the hands. In only one university, Shastra University in Tanju, in an audience of 350 people, 6 or 7 raised their hands. It was shocking. That turned the discourse in the world. It is not that you have a choice of accepting another religion as true or not. There was no question of a religion rejecting another religion. In fact, our religion accepts all religions as true. We don't pass judgments on whether some religion is true or not. You don't have the mandate to decide whether another religion is true or not. You know, this was something very new for a world which believed that only its God was superior, the other gods are inferior, and whether a God is superior or not, we will have a boxing match to decide. This is what Swamiji said. This is not our culture. And there he mentioned these two incidents. You know, when the Jews came to India, they were slaughtered, butchered, maimed and raped in 127 countries. India was the only country that was an exception. Swamiji mentioned it in 1893, that we kept in our bosom the remnants of the Jewish culture and civilization. You know, the Cochin king gave a plot adjoining his temple for the Jews to build their synagogue, and he gave them a principality, asked them to rule according to your lifestyle, according to your taste. You should not be affected by our lifestyle. You know who came and hit them? It is the Dutch people who came and hit the Jewish people in Cochin, because the old enmity, even 6,000 miles apart from that, the old enmity persisted, and they began hitting them here. 56,000 Marathi speaking Jews returned to Israel in 1947 when Israel was created. And in 1967, you say from 1893 to 1967, it's over 75 years, the Israeli consulate came out with a publication in which it said, the Israelis in India returned to build the commonwealth of the Jews, not because they were persecuted, because that is the only nation in which the Jews were not persecuted. Was there any constitution at that time? Was there any minority protection clause at that time? Was there any secular political parties at that time? Have you ever credited this nation with having lived and expounded a way of life and retailed it into the entire society, where anyone who is not like you will still be considered as someone who is a human being and he has to be protected? The same case with Parsis. The Parsi society has published a book in Bombay, you must buy and read that book, in which when they landed in Surat, the king called a meeting of the local Sabha and said, these Parsis have come, these Atithis have come, some 300 families with their holy fire, they had come, and they said, we want a place to put this temple, put the holy fire in the temple, we want a place to reside, and we want some agricultural land because we know agriculture. The king granted all the three and said, in return, will you be part of our society? Then the Parsi priest asked the king to bring a cup of milk, and he had brought some country sugar and he mixed it and asked the king whether you can see the sugar in this milk. That is how we will be with you. You know, in 1919, this psychology of being part of a larger society was in 1919, when communal reservation was offered to all the minorities, Parsis were the only one to reject it. Dadabhai Nawroji said, it is a conspiracy to divide us from the main society, we will not accept it. You know, the greatest doctor, the greatest industrialist, the greatest lawyer, is from the tiny majority of minority of 56,000, the tiniest minority in the world. Did anyone molest them? Did anyone discriminate against them? Have we ever branded India like that? Our culture, our civilization, our faith, our way of life. You know, all this is now in the intellectual discourse of the world. One Jean-Pierre Lehmann, who was the advisor to WTO, he is not a spiritualist, he is not a philosopher, he is not a religious person, self-declared atheist. He wrote an article on the 30th of March 2006 in the globalist.com. He was the advisor when Panich Pakdi was the president of the WTO, in which he said, how India is such a not only tolerant society, how it accepts other religions. He says, it is because Indians worship more than one God. He said, the capacity to worship more than one God is important for peace and harmony. You know, we had at one point 33 crore gods. Our population was less than that. So if you want, you could have average God was more than the average people. And you can worship any God in any manner you want. We created gods, we imaged gods in our own village. We used to go and worship the Ellai Kali, the border Kali temple of the village. We used to go offer banana, nariyal, and do harti and come back. A benign worship. At 8 o'clock in the night, the same God will begin eating goat and will go into booze. Because that is the kind of people who are worshipping her. The God did not change, the people changed. We never hated that Kali for boozing and taking goats. This is what Pierre Lehmann said, that if there is any one race, civilization, culture, faith which will make globalization work, it is only the Indian culture, because it is able to accept non-believer also as a legitimate person. Have you ever heard of Jabali in Ramayana? Jabali was the advisor as the minister of Dasharatha. So Rama was doing Tarpanam. So Jabali asked him, what are you doing? He said, I am pouring water for my ancestors. Where are your ancestors? See, they are there. You are such a fool. You are a king. you are supposed to show way to the world and to the people. You are believing in such superstition? It's in Ramayana. Rama gets angry. Then Vasishtha tells him, you remove this lack of faith from Jabali, see how great a minister he is. Have you ever read it? The tradition of living with people who do not believe in your God is what makes you a peaceful society. That is why you did not kill so many people. Have you ever realized it, read it, wrote about it, branded India like that, our culture, our civilization? It is so important. I am only giving you samples, examples, illustrations. I am not exhausting all that we need to do. Why I am saying this? How India has the tradition of tolerance? Was it created on the 26th of January 1950? Tell me. In fact, that constitution is a product of this culture. It did not create this culture. Have you ever done work on this? Sociologists, the sociology department of IIT Bombay, should it not do some work like that? Why it is important is, the world has been told that India is a demonic country. It has a demonic race. You know, in the dispatches of the evangelists during the colonial days, India was depicted as a barbarous nation, and that is why Karl Marx got the idea it was a semi-barbaric society. So it is important that we have to brand India. And branding India is a very important requirement for development of India, in which I want to tell you what Swami Vivekananda said in 1857. He said, I am not a believer in astrology and I don't dream, and I am seeing a vision which is as real as I am seeing all of you. I am seeing Bharat Mata sitting and ruling this world as Jagadguru. Anybody would have thought in those situations when India was down and out, its culture was over, India was all but a defeated race having accepted the British as the master. In fact, our Pauranikas began saying these people are Gandharvas who have come to save India. This was the kind of discourse, that was intellectual discourse that was going on. Swami Vivekananda said this. Anybody could have thought he is mentally deranged. In his 150th anniversary, on the 12th of December 2012, the National Intelligence Council of America came out with a report, The World in 2030, in which they said there will be only three major world powers, that is America, China and India. The man imagined in 1897, he envisioned, and it is being realized today. The Economist magazine, dated April 5th, 2013, carried a cover story, Can India become a great power? In which they write many things. What is India? India is often spoken of in the same breath as China because of its billion plus population, economic promise, value as a trading partner, growing military capabilities. All five permanent members of the United Nations Security Council support, however grudgingly, India's claim to join them. But whereas China's rise is given, India is still widely seen as a nearly power that cannot quite get its act together. How can you get your acts together when you yourself brand India as a country of rapists and killers? Then it is not a fact. China would never allow it to be done. Even if there is a comparatively high level of rape, they will say, I mean, in America there is more rape than in our case. They will defend it. It's not that even if there is one rape, it is wrong. We should feel ashamed as a country that there is such a thing in this country. But it is not a country of rapists and killers. Although poorer, less economically dynamic than America, India has soft power in abundance. They say it. We don't know it. It is committed to democratic institutions, rule of law and human rights, As a victim of jihadist violence, it is the forefront of fight against terrorism. It has a huge and talented diaspora. It may not want to be co-opted by the West, but shares many Western values. It is confident and culturally rich. Unlike China and Russia, it has few skeletons in its cupboard. With its enormous coastline and respected navy, rated by its American counterpart, India is well placed to provide security in its critical part of global commons. One big reason is the country lacks the culture. See, why? What is lacking in India? India's huge potential to be a force for stability and for upholder of rules based on international system is far from being realized. One big reason is the country lacks the culture to pursue active security policy. You know why? We lack the hardness. We need to acquire certain hardness. This hardness is lost because, I would dare say, Emperor Ashoka. There were two wars in the history of India. One is the Kurukshetra war and the other is the Kalinga war. When the Kurukshetra war was about to start, Arjuna developed cold feet and said, how can I kill so many people? How can I orphan people? How can I widow people? How can I kill my grandfather? I don't want to fight. Then Krishna had to tell him, it's your duty to fight. This is a war which has come unsought. It is your duty to fight. And then he takes him through gradations of consciousness. And he appeals to him. He tells, you are neither a man nor a woman. From then, he teaches him different kinds of intellectual perspectives. Karma yoga, jnana yoga, sannyasa yoga, moksha sannyasa yoga. Ultimately, in the 18th chapter, 63rd sloka, Krishna tells Arjuna, itite jnanam ahyadam guhya guhya dharam maya vimrsha yeta tate shena yate chasi tata kuru. I have taught you everything that I need to. It is now for you to choose what you want to do or not to do. Yate ichasi tata kuru, whatever you want, you do. A question came in my mind, why didn't he do it in the first chapter? Why did he take him through all these 18 chapters and finally tell him this? I asked a group of scholars whom I addressed in Cochin about 10-12 years back. That speech is on the, I think, YouTube, or it is circulating, I don't know, the text version. I asked them why Krishna did not do it in the first chapter. Why did he do it only in the last chapter? I want an answer. They could not, actually it was a huge gathering, they could not give the answer. I offered the answer myself. I said it only means Arjuna was so confused, he did not deserve freedom in the first chapter. Krishna removed his confusion and gave him the freedom of action. Now you come to Kurukshetra, Kalinga war. In the Kalinga war, the state of Ashoka was precisely the state of Arjuna before the Kurukshetra war. Oh, I have killed so many people, I have orphaned so many people, I have widowed so many people. There was no Krishna to remove his confusion. His confusion became the confusion of India. We began hating wars. But without a war, a country cannot survive. Without army, a country cannot survive. That is the security policy. Pandit Jawaharlal Nehru, in 1950, he even considered disbanding the Indian army. Because we have now struck chord with all, what is Panchashila is now sufficient. Till in 1962, China gave it in such a manner that we decided to build an army. Otherwise, we did not have an army. These weaknesses partly reflect the pragmatic desire to make economic development at home a priority. India's tradition of strategic restraint has in some way served the country well. And now, finally, the question that is asked is a question for all of us. That India can become a great power is not in doubt. The question is whether it wants to be. You can never be a power so long as you demonize yourself. demean yourself, debrand yourself, trivialize yourself. This is going to reflect in your economic performance also. Your brand can never be more than the brand of India. For example, I am a chartered accountant and I have a very wide practice. I have some of the important people in this country as my friends or as my clients. But when I go abroad, I am not just a chartered accountant, I am an Indian chartered accountant. The brand of India will govern my value. Just like a chartered accountant from, say, Zambia will be governed by the brand of Zambia. The chartered accountant from England will be governed by the brand of England. So that is why the consciousness from 2005 that you have to brand the country properly. I don't want you to tell lies. Tell the truth and brand India. I think high-end educational institutions will have to go into very, very critical facts and bring out these facts. It's not, you see, you need not have to go to retail level to gather facts. All these facts are available. For example, the Lancet magazine examined some 7,000 available studies and came to the conclusion that India and Bangladesh are lowest in rape rates. They didn't do any first level study. Their labeled data that is already available today, data is available with its source, who did it, what kind of method, what kind of sample, everything is there. Why not we do, why not the IIT sociology department do a study that Indian culture is not a culture of rape? Why should we ask M.R. O'Toole to write this? And if she had not written, this fact would not have come out. An alternative view of India, just as in economics, just as in trade, just as in savings, investment, just as its social organizations, family, community, all this produces a particular economic effect, a particular savings model, a particular investment model, which we will discuss in future. The culture also produces a particular way of life and the world needs it. And I think all of us are capable of high level intellectual performance only if we get into challenging areas. To endorse what is happening outside, you don't need to be an intellectual. You have to be only intelligent man. An intelligent man approves of what is outside and promotes himself. An intellectual takes on the challenge. He confronts, he defies, he questions, and he fights alone. If out of, say, 1,000 students who are the output of IIT every year, 10 students are of this kind, there will be paradigm shift in India. So, first session, I gave you a background of why there needs to be an alternative approach to Indian economic, financial and business model. And the second thing is why India's potentiality is not being fully realized, because we have not branded India truthfully and we allow India to be demonized and debranded, and that has a huge impact on the economic performance of India. And you must also look at this website, ANALT Branding Nations website, which gives you the different elements of how India is to be branded, how different nations are branded. India was branded in between 2004 and 2008 as number 4, satisfying all the questions, but it has fallen down. It is only because we have allowed a kind of propaganda to go on in India, which Maria Wirth, whose article I will be forwarding to you, says there are many forces in the West which does not want India's rise, and so they are trying to demonize and demean India so that its acceptability in the world goes down. And that is one perspective which we have to fight, because that has close nexus to projecting India's economic model, India's savings model, investment model as something which the world has to adopt. Now we are trying to adopt the Western model and have failed, which I will tell you how we have failed, how Germany has not accepted the American model, Japan has not accepted the American model. You know, in America 55% of the households are hooked into the stock market. It is 7% in Germany. Only 13% of the 9% of the Japanese savings gets into stock market. You know how many percentage of Indian savings get into stock market? Last year 1%. This year it is likely to be 300% more, that means 3%. You can understand the Economic Times will write 300% rise in savings into stock market, that is only 1 becoming 3. You know, this is how we deceive ourselves. We are a bank led economy. Why? Because we are a family led economy, that is why we seek safe savings. These are all culturally linked, integrated to our way of life. Ultimately, economics has nexus to the way of life. I will conclude it with a very unbelievable experience I had a month and a half back. Once James Maketa, you can note it and go and see his website. James Maketa, M-E-K-E-T-A, the Maketa Group. He sent me a mail. So, Gurumurthy, I want to meet you. And I didn't even know who he was. And then he came to my office after fixing appointment, 2 hours. He came with his wife. And he said, I am managing $800 billion fund in America. And $200 billion are government funds. $600 billion are government funds. $200 billion are private funds. And I am meeting you because there is alignment between your view and my view. I don't think these economies have any value. I look at the history of a country, its culture, its civilization, and I give the highest return to my investors. And when I invest into a country, I don't invest for 3, 4, 5, 6 years. I invest in a country for 30 years, 35 years. And I feel that India offers such scope. One need not have to invest in India for 3, 4, 5 years. I was shocked. He said, I don't look into this financial analyst and all that. I go into the society, look at the people, interview them, find what that society is. This has been my belief. Society is the largest and the purest open air university in the world. And I was shocked that an $800 billion fund CEO, feeling that you have to invest in the society and not in a country. So it is important to know India, properly brand India, and these two premises. Why the present session, what is the content of it, has come about through a certain background starting from 1991. And the second thing is that our economic performance is not as efficient as it should be because of not properly branding India. Thank you very much.
So, as you said that the UN reports India being the not being the rapist country in the world. So, sir, there can also be one more dimension, as you even said that there is less of policing. So, they can also be one more direction that most of the rapes go unreported, and as we all know that India has a history and even the present of bad policing. So, there can also be one more dimension.
That must also be studied, you know. You can't presume. In America, it has been studied. America report is one of the most underreported countries on rape. Proper reporting is there only in Europe. In India, underreporting is not possible because if there is some such offense, the village panchayat will deal with it. And when the panchayat deals with it, it deals with it so rashly, it gets into newspapers. So there is no study. In India, under-reporting is not even a proposition which has been raised in the intellectual discourse. You can't presume it.
So that means you say
that the IIT Bombay must study.
So I'm not in IIT Bombay, sir.
Where are you?
So I'm from Mumbai University.
The Mumbai University must study.
Okay, sir.
See, we should never. You can never presume something against India. You must say yes. If India is at fault, by all means investigate and report.
So I'm not presuming, sir. I'm saying that can also be one more.
There is no study. There is a study in America. In India, under-reporting is not even presumed because the total rape that is detected year after year from 2001 to 2011 is in the range of 21 to 22,000.
Okay, sir, that means we are saying that India has good policing?
No, good policing by the society.
Okay, sir, one more question I need to ask. As you said, Americans are branding themselves as soft power now. They were strong power. And then you are contradicting your statement, sir. In Kalinga War, Ashoka, he was a strong power and then he branded himself as this as his soft power.
But he gave up his hard power.
Which Gandhi
He gave up his hard power, which is wrong. America never gave up the hard power. They didn't destroy their missiles.
So that means you are saying we should...
Without hard power, soft power has no value. Only as Mahatma Gandhi said, only a strong man can be non-violent.
Sir, one more last
question. Sir, let others also ask questions.
Sir, last question I need to ask. Sir, as you are saying that we being Indian, we accepted all the religion. I just need to ask one thing. Did we really accepted Muslim religion, Christian religion, we being a people? In theory, yes, we have accepted in constitution.
It is only because Islam and Christianity do not accept other religions. Which is something which they have to...
And we being Hindus have accepted, sir?
We have... See, if Hindus have not accepted other religions, then they could not have lived here.
So that the other...
They are not arguing. It's a matter of fact, you know. Other religions exist here.
Not only that.
Any variation of Hinduism was also accepted by Hindus. Because there was no benchmark. This is the God with this address, with this email, with this telephone number. If you don't accept that God, we will kill you. That is not our case. You see, you must understand. This requires a lot of reading. I would like you to read the Encyclopedia Britannica on Hinduism, Islam and Christianity, and then talk to me in the next class.
So
these three chapters, Hinduism, Islam and Christianity,
sir,
in Encyclopedia Britannica.
I'm asking very general questions. I'm not an expert in the particular religion.
That is
a common man's question, sir.
I want you to read and ask me the questions.
So, but it's very general. Every person cannot come read with all
I am telling you now to read and ask questions. I am not saying that you should not. I say that because these are things which I have read. I want you to read and then ask questions.
So, I'll read some newspapers and come to general questions. I'll read.
I am of the same view that you said that Indian society is very tolerant and has given place to other religions. But the recent event that the Wendy Doniger's book was pulped, do you think this is the right way to approach religion in a country which has been the tradition for now? I mean, what I want to ask is the rightist wing, which goes by the Hinduism, isn't it destroying the very ethos that we nurtured for so many years?
See, actually, religious discourse should be limited to people who are experts in religion. Now, what is happening? People with other agenda begin writing books. That creates complications. The interdisciplinary study is necessary, but it doesn't mean one discipline can write about another discipline without knowing that discipline. For example, you want to write, Monier Williams wrote on Hinduism after studying Sanskrit. Doniger didn't know Sanskrit. So, this half-baked scholarship is bound to invite trouble. I am not justifying it. But the trouble is invited because you don't have the qualifications to write a book of that order, to make comments of that order, to draw conclusions of that order, it's inviting trouble. For example, if somebody has to criticize Quran, you must first read Arabic language. You can't just read an English translation of Quran and begin criticizing Quran. You will be inviting trouble. Okay. So these are issues. You cannot just go by newspaper comments. You must go deeper into why. Why nobody opposes Monier Williams? He was the first man to discover Sanskrit, read it. He built a Sanskrit English dictionary. So we need such scholarship.
So what are your perspectives on Dr. Ambedkar, the kind of branding he did of India, whatever little I've read about, read from him, based on his own experiences with the caste system?
You see, the caste system in the last 50, 60 years has undergone a huge change because of democracy. Caste system without democracy could produce enormously bad consequences. When democracy and caste have functioned, there has been a distortion by participation of castes in politics, no doubt. But our study shows, which this book has brought out, and all our travel across the country has brought out, now the sociologists have begun studying how the caste system in India has been able to work in democracy, taking advantage of the market economics and develop economically. The paradigm of caste has shifted in the last 50, 60 years. Ambedkar was right in whatever he said, given the conditions at that time. But now the conditions have changed. A relook at the whole thing is needed.
Sir, I totally agree about your point about branding and rapes and things have been coming in media, and we have been demoralized or whatever. But sir, I want a solution to that. It is all because of media, and it's been reaching throughout India and throughout worldwide. What would our approach be to counteract such things? Because it is, like as you said, it is very less in number. And it's been spreading throughout the world, and all the people, foreigners, has like looked down up to us. So what would our role be in the society to stop it or make awareness about,
See, as I told, for example, now Lancet magazine has done this study. The American government has done this study. Let the sociology department of IIT take up this study and find out what is the relative position of India in these 4-5 items: murders, rapes, prison population, and say this is the position of India. Even if there is some underreporting, yeah, there is underreporting. You must bring out the facts, for which some intellectual effort is needed. People have to work. I find the high-end educational institutions do not go into these challenging areas. They just endorse what somebody writes in some foreign magazine. But here, when something is written in favor of the Indian civilization also, that is not being endorsed. So I think there is intellectual lethargy in this country. We need to develop intellectual aggressiveness.
So,
one man can change, as I tell. For example, the IIT Bombay holds a seminar on this subject. Is India a nation of rapists and killers? Invite all the media. Place all the facts. The media cannot ignore. But we are not taking any initiative.
Sir, you talked about high tolerance level. Don't you think it also has a disadvantage, in the sense that we keep on tolerating the misbehavior of Pakistan? You know, they keep on encroaching our borders. So I feel that the high tolerance also has a disadvantage to it.
In the short run, in the long run, maybe after 50 years there will be no Pakistan, because Pakistan has survived only by hating India. And they are in deep problem today. I want you to go to Pakistan government's website. which has now changed in the last 10 years on the history of Pakistan. They have said that our ancestor was Takshaka, the king of serpents, and Taka race is the descendant of Takshaka, and Taka race is the one of the important backbone of Pakistan army. And then Purushottama, who fought Alexander in this place, he is the origin of Puru race, which is an important element of Pakistan's army. And in the Takshashila University, Chanakya taught in that university, Chandragupta Maurya, Ashoka, all of them studied in that university. We established the first university in the world. You know, there is a shift in Pakistan's mind. They are also seeking their sources. And you will find the entire art, music, culture of Pakistan is traced to pre-Islamic sources in that website. This is the Pakistan government's official website. One more thing, there is a huge influence of Bollywood on them today. If you see in the last 15 days, there is the Pakistan government is struggling how to stop the Hindi films from being telecast in Pakistan. They say if it continues for the next 25 years, there will be no Pakistan, because your heroes will be their heroes. Have you ever heard of Pakistan heroes in India?
No.
So they have a problem. You can't continuously hate somebody for 100 years. So Pakistan's survival as a nation is in doubt. But in the short run, what you say is true. They can give you all kinds of problems. So once somebody went to Kanchi Mahaswami, who lived for 100 years, and who was my preceptor, who told me not to get into power politics. Somebody said, no, all kinds of religious conversions are taking place, whether our culture will survive. And some of them claim that we will finish your culture and religion. This is the kind of, if you see the Joshua project and all that, which are put on the website, you can go and see. It is very, very provocative and very discouraging how in the next 100 years India will be converted and all that. So somebody said it is like, you know, the creeper which goes over the tree which is there for 300 years. And the creeper says that now we have topped you, I am now taller than you. And the tree said, no, you are the 1000th creeper I am seeing. Otherwise, a country which has lived for thousands of years, you know, there is some virility in this society. And that virility comes out of the fact that you don't react to immediate context. You know how to avoid contextual war, contextual disputes, contextual provocations. My only worry is that is being tested too often, and we should not lose that quality. Under no circumstances the mainline society in India should lose that steadfastness. On that, lot of work needs to be done. The provocation comes not from other religious groups. It comes from dissenters and secular thinkers within this group, which you don't think positively. That is going to be a huge problem in future, as I see it.
Thank you, sir.
Sir, you spoke about rape being projected in a bad manner. What about female infanticide? Is there been a study conducted somewhere in US and UK?
Now everything is being discussed about the gender ratios in India as evidence of female infanticide. You know what was the gender ratio in 1901 in India? 972, almost on par with the world. 1901.
Sir, Hindu reported.
Wait.
Hindu reported 3 million.
Sir, I am talking about.
In the last decade only.
Wait. Let me answer. No. Just sit for 2 minutes. In 1901, the gender ratio was 972. 1951, 946. 1991, 927. 2011, 940. It has actually risen now. You know, Bihar is one of the most backward regions in India. The gender ratio in 1901 in Bihar was 1061. 1951, 1000. 1991, 907. Now, this female infanticide takes place only in rural areas. The gender ratio is the poorest in metropolitan cities. It is better in towns. It is best only in villages. See, female infanticide is prevalent only in certain prescribed. For example, in Tamil Nadu, it is prevalent in Dharmapuri district in a particular community. It is there in a particular community in Punjab and Haryana and western Uttar Pradesh. These are not all India phenomenon. You can target and ensure that it does not happen. It is not a widely prevalent phenomenon. Why we have to say is, female infanticide is part of Indian culture. Where is the Indian culture? 972 was the gender ratio in 1901. You do not even know it. You do not even know that in Bihar, the gender ratio was 1061 in favor of women. We do not study. And we conclude. I feel the intellectual rigor that is needed to say things assertively is not there. I would like you to study this. Census details are available from 1901 completely. You go into it.
So, is there a complete reporting on sati, which is a part of Indian culture?
That is what this is why.
I mean, how far I can trust that?
No, no. This is an international report, it is not our report. It is an international report. Neometrics is an internationally reputed website on this. I will send you all the details. See, please understand one thing. You can question my conclusions. You can't question my facts. No, understand. I will never. I generally write in public. I have challenged people on facts. My conclusions can still be questioned. Nobody's conclusion is ultimately correct, except people who cannot be questioned, like Mahatma Gandhi, who had a certain vision of this. To question him, you needed certain qualification. I don't claim that kind of thing, but my facts will never be wrong. That is my reputation as a writer for 30 years, and here I am teaching you, and I owe it to you to tell only the truth and facts. Conclusions can be different, okay.
Sir, you mentioned that the Hinduism was a very tolerant religion, but sir, what about the dichotomy that has existed within us? Like, for example, in the Narayaniyam, it is always said Lord Shiva is talked of in a very derisive manner. And in the Shiv Puranam, Lord Vishnu is portrayed as a god with a lot of alangaram, who has a lot of ornaments, etc. So what is your take on this? There is dichotomy in Hinduism.
We have beaten our gods. You know, Thiruvayadal Puranam in Tamil Nadu. It's full of stories about how God has been beaten. So we can play with our gods. There is no problem. We can criticize our gods. You know, God is not somebody who is sitting 5,000 kilometers above with a sword in his hand. No. God is part of us. And it is to feel God within you. That is the ultimate purpose of spirituality. So, these mutual criticisms are always there. In fact, some of the poets have always criticized God. What are you? You are nobody. Shiva has been criticized as someone who is worthless by Shiva's devotees themselves. So, it's a all this has made you tolerant, that you can learn to hear criticism of what your God is one of the virtues of spirituality.
Thank you so much, Gurumurti ji. It's nice that a lot of questions are coming up. That's why it's not only one lecture, it's a whole course. So please note all your questions. And as he has advised, please see the facts and all the questions will be answered. I'll be very happy if more questions are raised next time, and he'll be happy to answer them. Thank you so much.